this evening. We have a very distinguished speaker, and I'm going to get as fast as possible to him. One of the things that Mark has been doing more recently has been working in a project at the Casa de la Solidaridad, and our various of you, I think, who have actually studied there at the UCA in El Salvador. My name is Charlie Byrne. I'm a teacher in the Graduate School of Education. I have a course on fundamentals of education administration, and some of the students are here today. So I'm not going to give them a quiz after this, but I think it would be a really excellent opportunity to take a look at educational administration, but with this kind of context. Before he entered the Jesuits, Mark had degrees in philosophy and engineering from Stanford. Now, talk about the well-rounded person, though. That was amazing. And then later, did a doctorate at Yale. So he comes to us really with an extraordinary amount of background and with some visual things, too, to be able to explain what's going on. And I'm particularly interested in hearing this. I went to El Salvador 20 years ago. I was one of the substitutes when they murdered the Jesuits there. And I went there as academic vice president, which was quite an adventure. So I'm very anxious to hear some of the things that have been happening in UCA since I left there. So without any further ado, Mark Rubin.
Well, thank you so much, and I'm really very honored and grateful, especially for all of you who have come through the rain today to be with us. As Charlie said, for the last few years, I've been teaching down in El Salvador at a program called the Casa de la Solidaridad. And part of that is a study abroad program for students from all over North America who come down to the UCA, who come down to El Salvador. And a key part of the program is that they go out to very poor communities, praxis communities, 2 days a week to accompany the people. And we're really privileged today to have Olivia and Carmela, Mary and Kelly, who are with us, who were part of that program, who will be saying a few words about that at the end. I have to say I feel quite humbled and really unworthy to be speaking today about the lives of the martyrs of El Salvador, the Jesuits and Elba and Selena. The other day, one of the daughters of this wonderful couple that runs the Casa, Kevin and Trina, kind of came into my office, and I was working really hard on the talk, and she said, you know, why are you working so hard? And I said, well, I'm going up to New York to give a talk, and it's the 20th anniversary of the Jesuits who were killed, and I feel really kind of unworthy to be talking about that. And Gracie, who you kind of need to know what she looks like, she looks at me, and with kind of a completely serious face, she said, why did they invite you? And this question has stayed with me, you know, kind of building my confidence. And although the martyrs have touched my life deeply through the lives of the people in El Salvador, I arrived in that country long after they had died. And as I was thinking about the talk, I was thinking perhaps it's that perspective that I can try to share with you today, because I suspect all of us in this room, with perhaps the exception of Charlie, really were people who arrive late and live on. We are the latecomers, we're people who remember. And perhaps this afternoon we can ask ourselves, what does the life and the death of these men and women, people who gave their lives really to speak out for justice, what does their witness say to us who come late and live on? I'd like to begin with their story. If you had been watching the nightly news on November 16th, almost 20 years ago, this is what you would have seen.
In El Salvador, one of the most brutal and violent days in 10 years of war, 6 Jesuit priests brutally murdered. During the night, gunmen invaded their dormitory, clubbed them, dragged them out to a lawn, and shot them.
We do not know who committed this heinous crime. Unfortunately, the history of atrocious death in El Salvador has come from the extremes of both right and left.
In 1980, our house was dynamited twice, rather heavily, and machine gun. In those years, we had to make a decision. Are we going to stay here in this country or to leave? So we, I and the rest of us, decided to stay in this country. We accepted the possibility that something would happen to us. Father Sobrino was attending a conference overseas when the Jesuit priests he lived with, their housekeeper and her daughter, were brutally murdered in El Salvador. When I was in Thailand, as I said, and when I got the news that Father Villaculia had been killed, well, I was shocked. But it was not a surprise, you know. It was a total surprise. Then when my friend from London, who called me, said, well, not only Villaculia, but Segundo Montes, and mentioned Martin Barón, I wanted the list to stop, but it didn't. And then Amanda Lopez and Father Lopez Lopez, Juan Ramón Moreno. Well, it was a terrible shock.
These images are shocking, I think. And where the bodies are seen there, there's now at the UCA a rose garden, which the husband of Pelba, Father Selena, planted rose bushes so that where bodies were, new life would come. And I think the horror of seeing these images is all the more real on a university campus, all the more powerful. Because in a very real way, these men and women, faculty members, staff of a university, died in a very clear and direct way because of what they thought a university should be and how they tried to live it out. In June of 1982, at an address at Santa Clara University, Father Ignacio Ellacarías said these words about the task of a Jesuit university, of a Christian university. He said, a Christian university must take into account the gospel preference for the poor. And this does not mean that only the poor will study at a university. And it does not mean that a university should abdicate its mission of academic excellence. Excellence which is needed in order to solve the complex social issues of our time. But what it does mean is that the university must be present intellectually where it is needed, to provide science for those who have no science, to provide skills for those without skills, to be a voice for those without voices, to give intellectual support for those who do not possess academic qualifications, to make their rights legitimate. And Ellacuría saw that this particular vision of a university demanded a certain type of academic, a certain type of intellectual, a certain type of student. In particular, he said that to have a Jesuit Christian university, we must first of all embrace reality. And this requires both an objectivity and a pragmatism. An objectivity to come closer to reality and to grasp it without fear, to look unflinchingly at what is the truth of the society that we live in, and then pragmatically to practice the art of the possible, to ask ourselves what is it realistically that we can do to work for the common good. He said that an academic Christian university must engage in prophetic denunciation, that we must have the courage to speak out against the evils that plague our society. And yet he continued, to end in this negativity is not sufficient, but we must present something more, a kind of utopian affirmation that people need to have an ideal to dream for, and that we as a university must be able to articulate what that dream is and how we must move forward to try to reach it. Now, this vision makes a university a threat. And to accomplish it, these men and women paid a steep price. And not just at the moments of their deaths, because they knew for years that their lives were in danger. And as Father John Sobrino, the great liberation theologian who you saw in the clip, said, they chose to stay, knowing that in a very real way, their lives were at risk. In that same address at Santa Clara University, Ello Correa said this, from 1976 to 1980, our campus was bombed 10 times. We have been blocked and raided by military groups and threatened with the termination of all aid. Dozens of students and teachers have had to flee the country in exile. And one of our students was shot to death by police who entered the campus. And our history, the history of our university, has been that of our nation. And yet he continued with these words. But we have also been encouraged by the words of Archbishop Romero, himself so soon to be murdered. It was he who said, while we were burying an assassinated priest, that something would be terribly wrong in our church if no priest lay next to so many of his assassinated brothers and sisters. If the university had not suffered, we would not have performed our duty. In a world where injustice reigns, a university that fights for justice must necessarily be persecuted. It's a hard standard. I come from Santa Clara University and I often ask myself, are we as a university suffering persecution for what we do to fight injustice? I remember a few years ago I was talking to John Sobrino, and he was kind of sharing with me this litany of things that were going wrong in his life. People who were putting up obstacles to his work, critiques that were coming from Rome, unfair persecutions and characterizations of what he was about. And I remember saying to him, John, how do you get up in the morning and continue to do this work? And he looked at me like you would look at somebody who was incredibly naive. And he said, Mark, look at what they did to Christ. Whenever we work to promote great good, we have to expect that there's an equal and opposite force that will try to stop us. And so he said, if I'm not encountering opposition, if I'm not encountering persecution, I have to ask myself, am I doing anything that's worthwhile? And I remember walking away from that conversation thinking of my very safe and comfortable life and thinking, nobody's been persecuting me lately. These men and these women can seem like heroes to us. And in comparison, as a Jesuit friend of mine, Jerry Martinson, likes to say, in comparison to these heroes, we can feel like hobbits. Plodding, shy little folk with clumsy bodies who love good food and staying at home, but who are also very loyal and who once in a while are capable of great courageous acts when friends are in need. So what do these martyrs' lives say to us hobbits? And again, to take my lead from John Sobrino, he says that we must, in asking this question, be careful of too quickly canonizing or turning the martyrs into heroes. He writes, beware of the well-known mechanism of admiration in order to avoid imitation, or in religious language of canonizing, sanctifying, in order to create distance. I remember when I first got to El Salvador, I was struck by how people love to tell stories that kind of highlighted the human foibles of these martyrs. They would love to tell stories about what a difficult person Ello Correa was in community, or how Martin Baró could be this incredibly kind of difficult and demanding professor and then would melt when he would go out to Hayaki with pockets full of candy to give to the children. Or a good friend of mine loves to tell the story about how Elba's dog chased her through the house and bit her. And I think they tell these stories because they want to humanize these martyrs. And I think the martyrs would have been pleased. Because I think more than anything, what they would have wanted was not to be sanctified, but to be imitated. Not to be canonized, but to be seen as an inspiration for a way that we could live. Earlier this year, a colleague of mine from the UCA, Dean Brackley, gave a beautiful talk on Eyo Kuriya's idea of a third force. And as is famously known, Eyo Kuriya constantly called for a liberation of the crucified people of El Salvador. And yet, he did not believe that this liberation could come or be produced by any simple military or political victory. Governments and armies alone cannot set people free. Rather, to quote Dean, Eyo Kuriya called for the organization and action of a third force to transform society, something that governments alone cannot bring about. Eyo Kuriya called for unions, the church, students, educators, professionals, small and medium businesses and working people, civil society, to organize and help not only to end the war, but also to build a more just social order from the bottom up and across the base of society. And I think Eyo Kuriya would have been delighted with how the current generation of students is seeing the power of organizing and becoming this kind of third force. I was just talking to Carmela about this amazing effort you're doing right now at Fordham to get people to go to the SOA, 2 busloads of people, right? That students believe that they have the power to work and organize for fair trade, to mobilize against sweatshops, to work as students and faculty and staff to promote social justice. This is Eyo Kuriya's dream of a third force. The world needs us hobbits as well as Gandalfs. But the urgency of this work of a third force raises a crucial question. In a world marked by great suffering, injustice, and disappointment, how do we, hobbits, keep investing in the often thankless work of being a third force? How do we keep giving ourselves without losing hope? Because let's face it, there's something a little scary and a little weird about celebrating the martyrs. After all, they ended up dead. They tried to speak out, and they were silenced. They devoted their lives to working for justice, and they got killed. So how exactly is that supposed to make us feel better? How is that supposed to give us hope? If anything, I think our culture might tell us this is a cautionary tale. Don't live this way, or you might end up the same way. Look out for number one, or else this might happen to you. A few weeks ago, I was giving some talks at St. Louis University, and after one of them, I received an email from a student whom I had never met before. And his questions were so penetrating, so moving, that I wrote and asked him if I could share some of them with you. And he said yes. And this is what he asked. How do you be as raw you human and as loving as Christ? How do you love? How do you share? How do you give others your heart without expectation of any return, knowing it may get trashed, will get trashed? How do you plan to keep doing that when your heart is going to get hurt, broken, unworkable? How do you be as raw you human and as loving as Christ? Now, I think these questions are questions we all ask. And I think they are questions that are intimately connected with how the martyrs might give us hope. You see, I think there are 3 moments in every life. The first, I might characterize as day one. It's that moment when we fall in love, when we can believe the dream, when we want to invest our life and pour our love and our energies and our time into giving ourselves to making a better world. We all know what day one feels like, and it feels good. But if we are realistic, we also know that day one is more often than not followed by a second moment, day two. That day when the dream is betrayed, when our love dies, when our heart is broken and we're tempted to withdraw and to lose heart. And I think in many ways this happened for so many people in El Salvador when the Jesuits and Elba and Selena were killed 20 years ago today. I'd like to share some video with you just to give you a feeling of what that moment was like. These are not sort of famous people. They're quite ordinary but wonderful people. The first is a man named Pablo Abarenga. He's known by some as Don Lito. If you've ever been on a delegation in El Salvador, he has a beautiful book. The other is a good friend of mine, a dear friend who works with the CASA, who helps accompany students in a community called Mariona. And I just would like to have you listen to both of their kind of words about what that day was like.
Se bajaban al ambiente de nosotros perros y le daban la mano a la viejita, al compañero con tubo, al compañero con kite, al compañero con sombrero, y que tal como que si era un camarada que había vivido y convivido con nosotros allá. Eso nos fue dando como, no sé cómo se llama esa palabra, una fuerza grande de identidad. Ya. Y empezaron a decir, vengan, oigan lo que acaba de pasar. ¿Y qué? Han matado a los jesuitas, ha de ser mentira. No creo que lleguen a eso, ese era el comentario. No, yo creo que eso es falsa noticia. El enemigo tira esta noticia. Era una confusión, pero poco a poco se va aclarando. Y hubieron llantos, hubieron silencios, hubieron pensamientos que nunca lo supieron, pero que la cara de los que la oímos decía mucho. Muchas mujeres se retiraron a ver de la noticia lloradas detrás de sus puertas, ¿verdad? Porque se iban figuras que en el sueño de la libertad eran como el abono para el caminar a paso más rápido. Sí.
¿Y cuál fue mi sorpresa cuando comenzaron a decir que el padre Armando López había sido asesinado, que el padre Juan Ramón Moreno también, que el padre Segundo Montes, que el padre Nacho, como lo llamábamos cariñosamente, ¿verdad? El padre Nacho. Para mí fue desconcertante realmente, ¿verdad? Porque eran mis amigos, mis compañeros, y yo sentí mucho dolor y me puse a cuestionar realmente cómo es posible que han asesinado a mis padres. Si eso lo han hecho con ellos, ¿qué no van a hacer con nosotros?
I show you those videos just to give you a sense of how alive 20 years later both the memory and the pain of this loss has been. Oti and Pablo represent just two people, but their stories are echoed across the pueblo of El Salvador. And yet this loss, this disappointment is not the final word. That following this kind of day two, there is a third day. A day when out of death comes new life. When love is renewed. When we somehow find the energy and the force to reinvest. To love again. To hope again. That we somehow find a way to reinvest in a world that breaks our heart. This, I think, is the hardest thing to understand, and it's what I would like to spend the rest of the talk reflecting on with you. How do we find that hope, and what is it? As is famously known, Monsignor Romero said, "If you kill me, I will be resurrected in the pueblo." that out of my death will come new life, and life in a way that you cannot even imagine it. And one of the things that makes being in El Salvador such a graced experience is this new life that has come out of death is palpable. There's a lot of very well-known examples that the death of the Jesuits, Elba and Selena, led in a very direct way to the peace that they worked so hard to achieve. This past year, when Mauricio Funes was elected president, the first president of the FMLN, the Progressive Party in El Salvador, since the war, there was this incredible rally at 1 o'clock at night. And the kind of the newly elected President Funes came before this huge crowd. And in his opening words, he said, "I dedicate my presidency to the memory of Monseñor Romero and the martyrs of the UCA." Something that I think the Jesuits, Elba and Selena, could never have imagined. A third example is Olivia, Carmela, Mary, Kelly here for me. All of the students that come to the CASA, literally the CASA program was started 10 years ago to mark the 10th anniversary of the martyrs. And every semester I have the opportunity to see these amazing young men and women come down to experience the reality of El Salvador and to let it touch their hearts. And again, I think this is new life that Ella Correa and the rest of those martyrs could never have even imagined. None of this could have been foreseen. It is endlessly new and endlessly surprising. But I want to move beyond just these kind of great and dramatic examples and share something that I think is far more personal. And I want to choose just one story that I think is emblematic of a thousand of other stories you might hear if you came to this graced land of the martyrs. The context is, I'm going to show you some footage of an amazing man, a friend of mine, Jose Dolores Guardado. He's known as Lolo to his friends. And Lolo is just one of the Salvadorans who accompanies CASA students as they go out to their praxis site. And last year we were making a very different kind of video, and we were just asking people in the praxis communities to talk about what they wanted to give to North American students who came to Salvador. And I just want you to listen to what Lolo says about what he wants to pass on.
No requerimos de tanto chunche para vivir, ¿verdad? Entonces, y también siento yo que ellas aprenden de los mártires, ¿verdad? Aprenden que nuestra fe no es una fe seca, ¿verdad? Solo de ir para ir a una iglesia y escuchar la palabra de Dios, sino que es una fe más insertada en la comunidad, ¿verdad? Una fe de vida, de martirio, ¿verdad? Entonces pienso yo que ellas aprenden eso con nosotros también, ¿verdad? Y lo más importante que también siento yo que aprenden a escuchar, ¿verdad? Quizás en las universidades por el trabajo, por el estar tan de lleno en los estudios, como que se olvida muchas veces escuchar a la otra persona, ¿verdad? Escuchar a la gente que tiene quizás problemas más difíciles que los que uno tiene, ¿verdad? Y entonces siento yo que eso aprenden también las estudiantes.
So this is a beautiful sentiment, right? He wants to share this faith of the martyrs. And at the same time, he says, I want to help people to learn how to listen. He says, here in the United States, we're so saturated with studies and our work that we really forget how to be present and to really listen to someone who might need for us to attend to it, to listen. Now, I was so struck because just a few months ago we were asking different people from the communities to talk about what the martyrs meant to them. And Lolo shared a story. And it was a story of how he first met Ella Correa. And he said he was a 14-year-old boy, and he had been hearing all of these people from the government kind of condemning this Jesuit priest as a communist devil and a rabble-riser working for the poor. And Lolo said, I just thought, this must be a good guy. So he convinced a lot of his 14-year-old friends to go to the UCA, where they were having sort of a kind of youth day. And he said, well, we're all going to go, and we hope that we can get to kind of see this famous Padre Eucuria. And this is what happened.
Yo dije, es mi oportunidad para saludar a Ignacio de Eucuria, ¿verdad? Después del festival yo me acerqué a él, por supuesto, ¿verdad? Y él me dice, ajá, ¿verdad? ¿En qué te puedo servir, verdad? Y yo le dije, nada más saludarlo, quería darle la mano y saludarlo, ¿verdad? Y porque tengo mucha admiración por usted, ¿verdad? Y él comenzó a preguntarme cosas sencillas, ¿verdad? Y de dónde venís y qué haces, ¿verdad? Y yo le comencé a contar, ¿verdad? Que veníamos de una comunidad, ¿verdad? Y que estábamos como a unos 10 kilómetros de la UCA, ¿verdad? Y él se interesó mucho, ¿verdad? Y me dijo, venite en la semana, ¿verdad? Y vamos a platicar, ¿verdad? Y yo recuerdo que estaba bien emocionado porque él me había dicho que viniera para platicar con él y eso, ¿verdad? Y vinimos con tres jóvenes más de la comunidad y estuvimos compartiendo con él como unas 3 horas, ¿verdad? Contándole la situación que vivíamos en la comunidad, que los jóvenes lo reclutaban forzosamente en esos tiempos, ¿verdad? De la comunidad Santa María de la Esperanza, en Ilopango, ¿verdad? Y él estaba como bien preocupado por esa situación.
I think it's so incredible to listen to that story. That what he experienced in meeting Eucuria was this faith and this willingness to listen to someone who needed an ear. And this is what Lolo repeats day after day after day with the CASA students and what he wants to hand on to them. This is something that I think Eucuria could never have imagined, how this one small act of hobbit-like kindness, right, could have led to this new life in a completely unforeseen way. And that out of this kind of personal encounter, Lolo continues to draw the hope and inspiration of his life. Listen to what he says about what the martyrs continue to mean to him.
Si no hubiera sido por los mártires, si no fuera por ese testimonio que ellos me han dejado, si no fuera por la vida que ellos entregaron, ¿verdad? Yo creo que yo personalmente quizás estuviera en un psiquiátrico, ¿verdad? O estuviera quizás decepcionado y no quisiera saber nada de la vida, ¿verdad? Estos hombres, ¿verdad? Que vinieron a dar el todo, ¿verdad? A cambio de nada, porque la lucha de ellos no era para tener grandes comunidades, para tener grandes edificios, sino era para el bien común de la gente más pobre, ¿verdad? Para que hubiera justicia, para que hubiera verdad aquí en El Salvador, ¿verdad? Entonces, para mí, personalmente, ellos siguen vivos, ¿verdad? Y los tengo muy presentes en mi corazón, ¿verdad? Y ese es el legado que yo quiero entregar a mis hijas, ¿verdad? Ese es como la herencia que yo quiero dejar a mis hijas, ¿verdad? Yo no tengo nada terrenal, no tengo nada material acá en este país, ni creo que lo voy a llegar a tener, pero no me importa, ¿verdad? Lo que me importa es que quiero dejar una herencia a mis hijas, ¿verdad? De compromiso, de martirio, ¿verdad? Y cuando me levanto todas las mañanas, cuando están muchas veces es cada vez difícil la vida acá en El Salvador, pienso en los mártires, Piensa en una ciudad judía, piensa en ser los montes, en Armando, en todos los mártires de la UCA, ¿verdad? Y siento como que saco fuerzas para seguir adelante, para seguir luchando, ¿verdad? Y eso para mí es como lo más grande que puedo tener en esta vida, ¿verdad? No me importa tener nada más, ¿verdad? Si tengo tan presente la vida de ellos, de su martirio y de su entrega para este país, ¿verdad?
I think it's incredible that Lolo would say, you know, I'm a man who will never have anything material. But what I want to give to my daughters, Karen and Maria Jose, is this faith of the martyrs. And that for me, they're still alive. And that they're what gives me hope to continue in a world that gets ever more difficult. I think Lolo's story helps to illustrate a difference between the hope that we find in the martyrs and the way that we normally hope in our culture. I think normally we live in a culture of mastery, a culture that is characterized by us hoping that certain things will happen. This kind of hope has a clear sort of outcome. I hope that I will get that fellowship. I hope that a certain number of people will go to the SOA. I hope that I'll get that job, right? Or I hope that I'll get that grade. I hope that I'll get tenure. I hope all kinds of things. And these things that we're hoping that we'll get, we often approach them in a quite willful way, as if we were in charge and we try to manipulate or coerce or force reality to give us what we think we so desperately need. Often this kind of hope comes from a context in which we believe that we are in control and that we can secure the outcomes that we think we so desperately need. And we're optimistic about our ability as privileged men and women to get those things that we need. In our culture, we often approach this in a quite individual way. I struggle to get what I hope that I need to get. And if I don't, the normal response is despair. I placed all my eggs in this basket. I thought he was going to love me, but he didn't. And now, how can I continue on? And I think oftentimes this very same kind of hope characterizes our religious imagination. We pray to a God whose job is to help things turn out the way that we want. And when we live in this kind of world, we're left feeling worried and anxious. What if what I'm hoping for doesn't happen? And what characterizes this world is a feeling of sadness, or anxiety, or emptiness. The martyrs, I think, invite us into a deeper faith and a deeper realism, because their lives and their death and the ongoing impact that they have tells us two things that our culture of consumerism and control want to deny. First, these lives tell us that we cannot be our own saviors. The truth is that our lives often don't turn out the way we want. We don't get that for which we hope. The dream that we invest in sometimes doesn't come true in the way we want. But that leads to a second and more important truth, that this failure, and at times even this death, are not the final word. That God draws life out of death, that light comes out of darkness, and that there are thousands upon thousands of stories like Lolo's that remind us that reality is infinitely more complicated and mysterious and confusing than we could ever imagine or foresee. and that the smallest acts of kindness or love can multiply and ripple down through the future in ways that our own limited vision can't imagine. The martyrs invite us to hope in a new way, to move from mastery to mystery, to move from a hoping that to a hoping in. A hope that does not expect particular outcomes, but rather stays open to what a future that is not our own is offering to bring us. A hope that grows not out of a willful attempt to master and manipulate reality, but a willing cooperation, an entry in to a cosmic participation of an infinitely interconnected world. A hope that arises not out of a sense of control and competence, but rather often arises out of a sense of trial and captivity, as the French existentialist philosopher Gabriel Marcel reminds us, that genuine hope always arises in the darkness, at a time where our own resources alone cannot secure the future we are struggling to obtain. And this kind of hope cannot be just an individual effort. It must be embedded within community, with a sense of communion and cooperation. And rather than despairing when the outcome we await does not arrive, we must await with patience that future we cannot yet see. Listen to the words of Lolo once again, describing what this hope feels like to him, and how he sees this endless light continuing to come out of the darkness of El Salvador, how this hope continues to spread.
Eso es inmune. Para mí es realmente la única esperanza que nos queda en este país, ¿verdad? Y yo pienso que en las comunidades, ¿verdad? Hay mucho de esto, ¿verdad? Mucha gente está hablando de los mártires y es como dices tú, en medio de una noche oscura, en medio de tanto dolor, de tanta violencia, en medio de una crisis económica que es como mundial y que nos afecta tan directamente acá en El Salvador, ¿verdad? Siempre el legado de nuestros mártires nos genera esperanza, ¿verdad? Nos genera vida, ¿verdad? Nos genera cada día cosas nuevas, ¿verdad? Por eso es que cada vez que hay, que está el aniversario de los mártires en la UCA, ¿verdad? Siempre es, para mí es la emoción, ¿verdad? De los farolitos, de la procesión de los farolitos y eso, ver cada año jóvenes, ¿verdad? Cada año gente nueva que está conociendo, que quiere conocer más de nuestros mártires, ¿verdad?
It's this incredible faith that he's talking about, that every year on the anniversary of the death, there's this amazing candlelight procession on the campus of the UCA, where people from all over the country ride on buses, they light candles in the darkness, and they invite young people to carry the images of the martyrs as a sign of this new life, this light that comes out of the darkness. And they make these incredible alfombras. They color salt, and they make these rugs with these amazing images and then process through them. This image, right, of going through the darkness, walking through these images of beauty with this hope that out of this ongoing struggle, light will arrive. And it continues to spread. I want to share another story from a dear friend of mine, Guadalupe Montalvo. She's a mentor for students. She's one of the cooks in the casa. And she tells a story of how she never really knew the martyrs and never would go to this vigil until she was invited there when she started to work at the casa. Listen to her story.
Después, cuando ya mis hermanas entran a la casa de la solidaridad, yo tuve por primera vez la experiencia de estar en una de esas vigilias. Y recuerdo que fue, aunque no les conocía, pero era algo muy conmovedor. Más cuando recuerdo que ya en la madrugada muchas personas estaban acostadas en la grama. Y fue bien bonito encontrarme con un señor que él venía, no recuerdo el lugar de donde él iba, pero él no podía regresar, tenía que casi todo un día para poder llegar. Y yo le dije, ay, ¿por qué está aquí? Y él me dijo, porque ellos son los seres que a mí me han dado vida. Y por ellos yo soy quien soy y mi familia es quien es. Entonces él, nunca le pregunté a quiénes él había conocido, pero él nunca se partía a las vigilias y venía con toda su familia. Y esa vez había venido con un niño quizás como de un mes. Y aunque su esposa estaba con ese bebé tan tiernito, no le había importado. Y andaba con suéter y con tapones en sus oídos y amarrada su cabeza. Pero ellos estaban ahí en la vigilia para conmemorar a esos seres que a ellos les había dado tanta vida.
I share this story, and I could share so many others with you, to give you a sense of what this hope of the martyrs means in El Salvador. I just learned today that there's a delegation of students who are going down from Fordham to be with us at this very vigil. And so there'll be new people, again, coming to experience this life and to bring this life back to New York. And for me, in showing all these connections, I want to suggest that the hope of the martyrs is not a hope that just flows because they were great people who led great lives. That it's about something very different, about something much more. You see, I think there's a really bad picture, a dangerous picture, that looks at the martyrs and it says they were these amazing, heroic people, these giants. And I should be a giant too. And I think this picture can really be dangerous because it can set us up for a sense of failure. Because it's really very, very difficult to live your life like a storybook hero and to believe that everything rests upon what you can secure and accomplish through your own greatness. This is why John Sobrino says, be careful not to canonize or sanctify the martyrs. If you ask yourself and you think about it, there's all sorts of great people in the world today. But they do not animate a nation the way the martyrs have done and continue to do in El Salvador. There's all sorts of great individual figures, but they do not continue to give hope and life 20 years after they have died in the way that these Jesuits, Elba and Selena, continue to do in El Salvador. So what's going on? What I've been trying to suggest is that in the end, the hope of the martyrs is not just about the great things that they did. It's about the faith they had and the God in whom they believed. It's about a deep conviction that there is at the heart of being a goodness that draws life out of death, brings light out of darkness, and that if we sacrifice ourselves, there is something more, that we are players in a play that is far greater than anything we could imagine, anything that our own little plans and dreams could ever imagine. And if we just had to rely on our own power and our cleverness and our goodness, there really would be no reason for us to pour out our lives in the struggle for justice. Because as our culture of individualism tells us, in the end, we're going to suffer. We are going to encounter disappointment. And it really doesn't just make sense if you think you're going to secure the dream in the way that you initially believed. But the life and the legacy of the martyrs says something more. That this culture of fear and individualism is not the whole story. That there is, again, at the heart of being a grace and a goodness that refuses to let death be the final word. And it's a promise that if we truly do pour out our lives in love, then even though it seems to be leading to disappointment and even to death, we will find new life. And that new life will come from our efforts. If the martyrs give us Hobbit's hope, it's because they lived out this mystery. And in their lives and their death and their ongoing impact in thousands of ordinary lives across the nation of El Salvador, we can taste and see and touch the resurrection that Monsignor Romero promised. There are three moments in every life, 3 days. And we celebrate them as a church every year. The first day, day one, is Holy Thursday. It's that day when we wash feet, when we pour out our love into bread and wine, where we believe the dream and we receive this love and we hear the command that says, go and do likewise. Do this in memory of me. And in that day one, we truly believe that we have nothing that is better or more worth a life than to pour out our life in love the way that we too have been loved. But what makes our faith worth believing is that it's realistic. And it tells us that to live out this dream has a cost. That inevitably, day one, Holy Thursday, is followed by a second day, Good Friday. That our efforts to build a more just world will be met with opposition. That our love will be betrayed. That people will deny us. That friends will abandon us. That there is a cost to pay to live the call. But our faith also promises us this, that day two is not the final word. That inevitably comes a third day, a day of new life and of resurrection, of Easter, when love is reborn and we find the hope to reinvest in a world that has broken our hearts. There are 3 days in every life, and they happen over and over and over again. I'd like to close by sharing with you one last example of this kind of hope. It comes from a student video, so I'm going to be showing you something, and it's definitely not professional quality. The day before she made this video, I remember she was running around the casa and she was saying, I have this video and it's due on Friday and it's Thursday morning. Does anyone know how to use iMovie? And I was thinking, oh, this does not sound good. So she had never used this program before, but she had this kind of vision that she wanted to share. And to understand the video, you need to kind of realize that you're going to be seeing videos of this praxis community named Tepecoya, where she would go out and accompany the people. And when she and this group of students went out, and you'll see them teaching some English, initially they couldn't speak Spanish all that well. And so one of the things that they started doing was having dance parties out there. And they didn't realize it, but the community had actually just really been through some incredibly hard times, was really feeling disheartened, and having these three crazy gringos show up and kind of dance with reckless abandon brought them this incredible sense of sort of joy and hope. The student who made the video really struggled with the whole sense of day two when she encountered the machismo in the Salvadoran culture and the really abusive way that women are treated in so much of Latin America. And so you'll see images where she gestures to that. And lastly, you'll see gestures. The video is going to start in darkness. And what it is it's a candlelight procession. Not at the vigil, but out in the countryside. And it's a candlelight procession not to celebrate the martyrs, but to celebrate the Easter Triduum. Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter. So you'll see these images of a procession. You'll see these crazy people that are dressed up like Roman guards. That's Good Friday. You'll see some people getting kind of tied to a cross. And so she's trying to say this hope of the martyrs is connected to this deep mystery of our own faith. I hope you enjoy the video.
Thank you. And it's not a cry that you hear at night. It's not somebody who's seen the light. It's a cold and it's a broken hallelujah.
Something in this world that is endlessly surprising. It's cold and it's broken, but there is an alleluia. This video, I want to end with showing you a final clip, and it's very raw. It's a clip of the student that you saw dancing with the red sweater just a few days after she arrived back in the United States. And she's talking, you can feel the tension in her. She's talking about this choice to live in a different way and what she thinks it might cost.
Well, I learned a lot about what kind of the reality is. For what reason am I doing that? And I guess kind of reevaluating
smile at the end, I love. And what she doesn't say on the video, she's too humble, is she's really one of the most brilliant students I've ever taught. This unbelievable pre-med who has just won every award at Santa Clara and at her high school and just accomplished whatever she wants. And you can just sort of hear her choosing and saying, what's really worth this one precious life? Is just gathering ever more awards and accomplishments and personal success. In the end, is that enough? And is that an adequate response to the love that I receive in this cold and broken hallelujah? I think there's something in each one of us, some still, small, quiet voice that invites us to dream, that tells us that our lives could be about more than just my own small personal success, that invites us to believe that I really could give my life in service of this vision of making the world a more just place. That I could pour out my life to wash other people's feet. That I could pour out my love to be that presence of grace for those who are broken. The hope of the martyrs tells us that this is a dream worth believing. Not in some kitschy, sentimental way. The hope of the martyrs tells us that if we give our lives in love, we will pay a cost and we will pay a price. But that same hope tells us that whatever the cost and whatever the price, even if it's death, that will not be the final word. The world needs hobbits as well as Gandalfs. And for all of us hobbits tonight, I hope we can hear that plea, hear that call, hear that dream that life comes out of death and light comes out of darkness. And in the words of the prophet Isaiah, be not afraid. I go before you always. Come follow me, and I will lead you. Thank you very much. Some of the costumes are just going to say a little word. They're so much better than video. So, Carmela, do you want to go first?
It's not nice to follow. I don't really need podiums. There's not enough room for my hands to talk, but I'll make do. It's awesome, Joe. Thank you. Okay, so I just wanted to say that it is us. It is we that are privileged to have Mark here with us, and of course, to be in the position that we're in, to be here at Fordham, to have the ability to sit in this room and have these conversations as participants in the Fordham community, as community partners, a lot of whom are sitting here with us. And I want to thank Mark, and ask that we all apply what has been said here to our lives, to our local communities, and also and especially for those of us who are going down to the School of the Americas in a couple of weeks, to look at and carry with us how interconnected we are. To look at the lives of the martyrs and see that they spoke out and dedicated their lives to justice and that they were not the only ones, and to always carry that with us as well. To look at who is speaking out and who is being martyred as well in the struggles within our communities, and to see what hope and strength and new life that we can draw out of that, that we can find in those struggles, that we can find in these lives, and that we can find in the community that we're so privileged to be a part of here. I was at the CASA, so seeing these videos is a little bit emotional. I was with a lot of these people last semester. It was a really incredible experience, and we also have our friend Kelly, who you got to see on video. here with us as well, and her friend Mary, who was at the CASA the semester before, in from Scranton University to be with us today. And when this is over, anyone who's interested in hearing more about that program, Olivia and Kelly and Mary and I are going to stick around to chat about that if you'd like to talk about our experiences. And there are many stories that come through my mind that I thought about getting up to talk about, but I think I can't do them justice, really. So I just wanted to say what I said about finding that strength in your life and community.
As Mark was humbled by Gracie, very humbled to try to say anything after Mark or Lisa, but earlier today at the study abroad fair, I found myself having to plug the CASA program. So essentially boils down to intentional community living within a reality very different from our own. And I just reminded of how incredibly difficult it is to articulate an experience like El Salvador. So I give Mark and anyone who attempts it all the credit in the world. Again, just to thank him for being here with us today. The hope of the martyrs is something that really touches everyone, I think, that goes to El Salvador and enables us. Erin actually was my roommate in El Salvador, so I'm missing her a lot and trying to channel her right now. She's a lot more articulate than I am. But just this Salvadoran imagination that allows us to struggle together through the questions that we live. You know, how do we hold together the suffering and joy that we experience in our world, and especially in a reality like El Salvador. So five months later, I miss El Salvador with every fiber of my being, almost every moment of the day. It's changed me in ways that I could never have imagined. And I just remember like the first week that we were there, our RA in the CASA room, our RA, Colin said, the only hope that I have for you is that this experience rocks you to the core. And then a few months later, Dean Brackley was speaking to our parents when some of them came down to visit us in El Salvador, and he said, you know, your kids have been shaken upside down. So, you know, all I can think about is going back at this point. And so the feeling that I have right now, what I'm left with, is gratitude, amazing gratitude for the people that I've met, the experiences that I've had, and the ways in which that it continues to change. I mean, I think that's sort of the legacy of the martyrs, at least for me. So thanks, Mark, and for everyone for being here.
I want to thank Mark for that wonderful presentation. And now we want to invite you to meet the CASA girls, or you can have some pizza next door and to continue the experience. And many of you will have questions for Mark. I know your time is probably limited.
No, I'm happy to stay.
Excellent. Good. So let's move over to the social lounge for some pizza and some good conversation.